D&D Beyond, all that stuff, what's been going on? So we start up here. For those who may not know, again, I'm going to be doing this as a video anyway, so if no one really shows up to watch, it's going to be transferred to the YouTube page, which the links are down below. If you guys want to see that, check it out. But basically what's been going on is Wizards of the Coast has with their one D&D, their new sort of way to play where they're pushing a more digital frontier with it, is come out and stated that they are going to be doing a new OGL, open game license, basically a sort of royalty-free public domain-esque thing for role-playing games. So for like D&D and stuff, this is what lets you be able to say DM on and things, or games like Knights of the Old Republic, where they use feats and traits and skills and level up. Basically, any sort of RPG you play out there that has any sort of like feat system, leveling, skill points, levels, XP, classes. Basically, all that is because of the OGL, and you're allowed to say it in that way, sort of way. Then, thus, this year. Slash the end of last year, they came out and said that they were going to be changing this. And normally you're like, okay, this is that, it's changed. But what they didn't tell us was the huge change, which we'll get into here, which affects creators and games and all that stuff out there. So starting with that, there was one called OGL 1.0, which was the first one, which was kind of warning us like, hey, it's changing and we're going to be, doing this new system. Keep an eye out. This kind of got people kind of scared because they did came out a long time ago when they created it originally, stating that this OGL that they made will never be touched, like it would never be changed, because they knew, the people at least at that time knew, that these games are going to be made out of it. Yeah, so they came out with that, and they've decided to, they're going to be changing, which meant that would lead into basically this 1.0, which had basically stating if you make a certain percent of money, you have to claim it to them. Basically, you have to run a business deal and you have to sign this license with them, which they have complete control over, and you can't basically fight against. So that was kind of like the major thing that was coming out, basically stating all those people who are kickstarting stuff, making cut like community-made books for 5e or video games based off of loosely based off the D&D settings, or not setting even this, just the D20 system, was going to get hit by this thing, basically this new OGL. A couple of days after, they came out stating a 1.1, which was more in detail, and with people leaking it with actual evidence, it became clear that WotC was basically becoming the next Games Workshop, following their arc of business leveling. Basically, every business, even YouTuber, VTuber, whatever, goes through this sort of cycle. And WotC is, which means Wizards of the Coast, is currently going at this. Now, this could be actually Wizards of the Coast doing it, or Hasbro, because Hasbro is their owner. And I could see Hasbro pushing this more than Wizards of the Coast, because they're trying to. They've come up to say that they want to basically mass market this thing. They want to do games. They want to do movies like we see with the Chris Pine movie that actually looks pretty good from the trailers and all that stuff. So they are doing that. This led to Paizo and Cobalt Press and a bunch of other companies coming out and stating that they weren't cool with this and that. They, in response, are making their own version of the original OGL called ORC, or ORC. I'm not 100% sure what the acronym means. I forgot to write it down. was kind of expecting to have people kind of chatting with me to ping off of. I'm not really good at just rambling by myself about things in detail in a stream setting, so forgive me for that. But yeah, so there was that. This also caused a lot of people to cancel their D&D Beyond subscriptions. A lot of streamers on Twitch here or YouTube, like Critical Role, were threatened with this, and a couple of people I think even got hit with actual like paperwork, or were like they got like a example shown to them what it would look like. I know Kickstarter, the owner of Kickstarter, came and had a discussion with the PR or accountant person who's ever in charge of that part with of Hasbro, and they've made a deal that you can actually, I think it's if you make more or less than normal what they were asking for you to report, you can do it. So Kickstarter people can get like make more money before they have to report and like give a percentage to Hasbro, which leads into the next part here. Critical Role has come out and made a statement about how the about it. I know they weren't doing it originally because it is their biggest supplier, like it is their biggest advertise, you know, the person that pays them for advertisement, it because they are playing their game and it's they made it super popular, and plus the game itself is just good. So this has caused a lot of that to happen, and it's just a lot of angry people. Pazio, I don't think, is going to be that much troubled. I know a lot of people are saying, like, oh, Pazio is going to shut down Pathfinder, or this game is going to shut down. Pathfinder has kind of, with Second Edition Starfinder, they have made it their own unique game. Following them since the very beginning, I've watched them, like, what their takes on things. They wanted to get away from the OGL, but they signed it and stuff because it was some of the original creators of like 3.5 and all that stuff. So they kind of kept it, and they were able to make their own versions of the role-playing system. So they are legally distinctive. So they're fine. Cobalt Press is making their own game system for their stuff. So yeah, is it as huge of a problem for those who say make their custom, like say you make a custom race and you write it on like a Microsoft Word document and share it with a server or Reddit or something. Not really. It wasn't going to affect from reading the stuff that I saw. Making third-party stuff, we'll call just anything you make to be used with D&D 5e or any sort of role-playing game or an established game that you has a license for, we'll call a third party. So making third-party material for sharing with friends for homebrewing, you're not as long you're not selling for the purpose of selling or producing like through a Kickstarter, that stuff's still protected. You're still allowed to do that in this. It's when you become a business, and this is where the warning for the hot take. I'm gonna there's something I was gonna say. Hot take I was gonna go into, and this also leads into that whole money thing I was gonna lead into. And personal hot take is, as much as it kind of does hinder a lot of people, and I'm not going to be a Wizards of the Coast, like, fanboy, supporter, whatever you want to call me. They do technically, as a person that owns a license, have some sort of legal right and maybe even a morality right to do this OGL chain. Is it a good thing? Not really. I'm not into the super fine details of it, but as a company who makes an item which you're making content for and you're profiting off of its popularity, there is a moral gray, there is a gray legal line there for that. And it sucks, and people who do make stuff should have some protection. But in the end, if you're making something that has logos, has content, clearly is saying it is meant for this thing that's already made, people had like companies and stuff have to pay, royalties. They have to get confirmations. They have to follow rules and stuff. So it would make sense that with the popularity rising, though, it is kind of a dick move that they're doing it now with this new system coming out, and they know their stuff is popular, that they're changing it out of nowhere for it. But as a company, again, you are making content using their stuff and their game system for their game system, and you are making money off of it without, talking to a lawyer, unless you are, say, a company who has talked with Wizards of the Coast, or you do have a partnership, like how the people of like Matt Mercer's Critical Role there has made books with Wizards of the Coast, that sort of thing, that stuff. Them, they do have a legal department. They've been doing it for a while. They've talked with them. They are a partner, basically, with, like, not a full partner, like a third-party partner with Wizards of the Coast, and they should be protected and, not be screwed over by this new LGL. But, like, a lot of these people who make these Kickstarter books, like these campaign books or Better Creatures books and stuff like that, they were making books for this game system that is a established legal title that has copyrights and stuff. So profiting without paying a copyright fee or a sort of thing like that is, again, a gray area. The fact that Wizards of the Coast has, so that's like my devil's advocate side of it, stating that they do have a right to do this. People have been profiting off popularity and their stuff, using it to make money without any sort of contact with with legal representation and stuff like that, or paying fees and stuff. This is where the why this situation, I think, is more unique than others, and is that the fact that Gary Gygax and others who honored him through continuing their work with like 3.0 seconds, stuff like that, 3.5, has come out and they stated that the OGL was there because they wanted people to do this. They wanted people to be able to use their stuff to create things without fully, infringing on copyright. They wanted people to be like, yeah, I'll use, this is a cool idea. I want to, like, they can just make like a JRPG or like Knights of the Old Republic, that sort of leveling character system. They want to use that, and it's generic enough and it's cool enough that they're like, yeah, you're allowed to do that. And this OGL will protect that. It would protect people who wanted to make third-party books. Again, as long as you were, it was clearly blatantly enough that it was its own thing, and it just happens to be able to, use the very bare minimum core system of a D&D edition. So that's where this hot take, like this whole situation, is what getting people messed up. It's because now Wizards of the Coast is showing their true colors, which, if you've been playing Magic, you've seen before with this new stuff that they've been doing ever since COVID. And it's not cool. Games Workshop has fallen to this, but they have fallen a long time ago. It's a shame that Wizards of the Coast is now doing this due to popularity and trying to get money in it out of this whole community. And yeah, so that's kind of like what's going on. Talking about the money thing, they've stated if you, what is it? If you make, so this is like the in-depth stuff that they're talking about, the whole like money contract stuff. You have to make a contract. They can change the OGL at any time within, but they have to give you 30 days notice. 25% of you make over 75,000 USD. Would get, you have to pay them again royalty fees. Kickstarter made it so it's 20% instead. And then again, as I was saying, how the original creators and stuff of OGL did this to protect people who wanted to create and help with their world and make cool fun books and sell and use to make games and all that. Because they knew D&D, and because they made D&D because of like Lord of the Rings and stuff. They knew that this was going to be, a huge changer. It might not have been a huge like pop culture change like we see nowadays, but But they knew books, games in the future, be it like in any form, was going to use this as a base at some point. And so the original guy who made slash helped make OGL1, like the OG one we've been using forever, came out and is now in a legal battle with Wizards of the Coast over it, because he's not a fan of this change, which then has caused Matt Mercer to come out and speak about it now, and all this stuff. It's just been a hot mess. Just like this 8-rad, it's freaking full of flash. Holy jabibis. But anyways, so that was the big changes. Again, if you want to use any sort of their symbols, their terminology, all that stuff, that counts towards it. Streaming would be hit by this, with content. If viewership is high enough and you make enough money off ads and things and subscribers, you'd have to report it. Anything you want to do, you'd have to be like, "Hey, WotC, I'm making this book," or "Hey, I want to st we're streaming this homebrew campaign I made." In exchange for this, another thing this would do is cause Wizards of the Coast to own a chunk of your stuff. So at any point, they can use as so assuming you've reported what you've made, the Kickstarter you're doing, you've paid your fees, and you've signed the contract for this, because you have to, because you're making money. Then at any point, Wizards of the Coast could come out and claim your stuff as their own. They can use, say, just like Minecraft did, if say you made a custom race for your or setting in a campaign you wrote and sold on Kickstarter, or even say in a local game store, you printed it out yourself and you're selling it at local like mom and pa shop, Wizards of the Coast could take that character you made, that NPC, that race, that setting, and put it into a book of their own that they want to sell. Now, this is again companies then like businesses that sign contracts with people that let you build stuff, crossovers and things like that. They have something like this. They usually do something like this. But normally, the people who made the thing that they're crossing over with still has rights to their thing. They can say yes or no to it. They get a percentage of the money, or they should. But Wizards of the Coast will not have to. So when they basically pulled an Uno reverse card on the community for this. That's really it for that big change. So in response to this, now this is where we're catching up here. This is where we're getting closer to what's been going on the last 2 days. They've come out and said, "Oh, this is in response to Matt Mercer, the original OGL guy, Tazio, and all of them kind of grouping up to make their own like Image Comics of OGL." They've come out to basically state to them that this was a oopsie poopsie, and we were just getting some we're just getting some feedback on it. It wasn't official, which to be fair it wasn't, because it was just leaks. They never came out with it. So they've recently made a statement that has said that they're currently reworking on it, and they're pulling back. And from what I've seen quickly here, a lot of 2.0 stuff is basically backpedaling on their original stuff. As I finish scraping this, I'm going to pull up a document and we're going to read basically what's been going on with 2.0, because that's currently where we're at right now, is the 2.0 thing. So they're basically coming back. They're backpedaling from it, saying like, "Hey, this wasn't official," or "We're sorry," stuff like that. They're basically trying to get good graces again with the community. And it's just insane to see this happening here. So that's basically it for that part. Anyways, so we have the document here. We have an official update from them from yesterday. There we go. Oh yeah. So when we initially conceived the revisal of OGL, It was three major goals of mine. First, we wanted the ability to prevent use of content from being included in hateful discriminatory products. But what do they deem as hateful and discriminatory? Because that was one thing this a lot of people. Come on, let me. Okay, it's not letting me highlight it, but hateful and discriminatory products. In a good in a world of trusting people, this could be a good thing. Yeah, you don't want people making, the bad stuff with the the spicy pinwheel and all that, using their game as a sort of hate teach program. But again, it's Wizards of the Coast could still just be like, yeah, no fam, just delete and remove your stuff. So they could just use it as like, oh, we thought this was a thing, and then remove your stuff. So that was one thing. Second, we wanted to address those attempting to use D&Ds in Web3 blockchain games and NFTs by making it clear that OGL content is limited to tabletop. This is the big one. That was in the original leaked statement that a lot, like, this is the one that made Pathfinder, Paizo, and video game companies come out and start suing and actively working together against Wizards of the Coast. Because this basically would state that any video game, any movie, any pictures you draw, anything that is not you playing it on the table with officially licensed product or homebrew made things you made for your friends, gray area being, streaming, would not be allowed. It is they as unless you pay Dad Watsy, Big Brother's watching, you couldn't do anything. And even something like this I'm doing is skimming their thing. So this is what was the biggest of the problems next to the money one. And so there's that. So third, blockchains. And third, we want to ensure that the OGL is for the content creator, the homebrewer, the aspiring designer, or players, the community, not a major corporation. Again, in their right to do so, I can see where they're coming from. Protect the IP because D&D has become such a big household name. They don't want. And they've what? Because remember that these guys are the same guys who do Magic. They do Avalon Hill, like, Axe as an Ally and House on the Hill. Card games, they did Pokemon to begin with. So they do have a large name, and they've had issues in the past, like the Invoke Prejudice fiasco or situation that happened. I know I'd say fiasco. Fiasco that happened in the early ages of Magic the Gathering, their card game. That I can see why they threw this in. Again, though, how it was stated in the original leaked document, anyone basically, any form of you made this thing and you put it on a website that may have mon that could have potential monetary value was gonna get. They weren't gonna, like, say, s allow the YouTuber who wants to sell a like a great one is, actually a local person, like not local in the sense that same country. I recommend watching our videos. She's a lady who does the video about the monkey paw running around in the Fool's Gold. I forget. I'm sorry if I remember. I'll post it later on in the chat. But say someone like her, who's making a storyboard semi-animated story about her game, turning it into a story. And then wants to sell, due to high demand from the viewers, wants to sell the campaign that they are playing. Help them. It's just a couple of people. They're not looking to make millions off this thing. Maybe that, like, like your usual, like, thousands after a popular Kickstarter. So someone like that would be protected from this, from what I've read through the, and watching a couple of videos talking and seeing this, as we can see on the screen, what's supposed to be protected but how they originally wrote it, they were going to have to pay money from it, sign over a contract, because they made a lot on that Kickstarter. Like, a lot to me, a peasant, it's a lot of money. Like, that's a money that would last me a good chunk of time. And so they'd have to have signed a contract with Wizards of the Coast, give them, 20% of what they made off of that, which was going to be, again, like thousands of dollars. And maybe you're thinking, oh, to a multi-million dollar company, thousands is chump change. Why are they caring? Because there's a lot of D&D stuff out there. That's why they care. Their name. And again, Games Workshop did this too. They are some of the worst people to work with for a business I've ever seen in the hobbies, game store scene working there. And Wizards of the Coast has become that now. Let's just hope they don't go after singles and regulate that for Magic the Gathering, because we're fucked if they do. But anyways, so that's that. So they've come out and they're saying that they didn't mean to do that. Again, there's that oopsie poopsie. And then, so we go to the next paragraph here. Driving these goals were two simple principles. Our job is to be good stewards of the game. You guys don't really play test your games anyways. You're not really watching what people want. You're kind of just pushing things, as we've seen with, as we've seen with Starfinder has its own issue, but it's a cool game. I really like it. Their sci-fi one that they just released as a box set. Yeah, there's that. The original OGL existed for the benefits of fans. That's what was there. So, next thing here. That's why our early drafts of the new OGL included provisions that they did. The draft language was provided to content creators and publishers so their feedback could be considered. Then, from what I've heard and seen from other publishers and reading their stuff, the guy who is the CEO of Pazio, especially the Pathfinder side of things, Jason, he's really good at communicating with the community. He's been, making sure he's taking the time to read everything and get his thoughts down so that he can tell you what's going on. Highly recommend checking Facebook or Twitter. He's pretty awesome. I don't know him personally. He's done in some He has interacted with me though, so he's cool. Recommend checking out him if you want to know anything going on with Pazio and his thoughts on this and with the orc system that's going to be coming out. So yeah, so we can get the feedback again. No feedback was given, in addition to language allowing us to address discriminatory. So basically, so they can reward it better, so that they can, kind of, they'll keep hitting us with these leaks, quote unquote, until we start calming down or it washes away, and then they'll just say, okay, these are the languages, like this is what we use for jargon. So yeah, clarify OG covers. Our drafts include royalty language designed to apply large corporations attempting again. Understanding if, say, a large company out there like EA wanted to make a video game based off D&D using the D&D system, but maybe a different setting, and they don't call it really D&D, or a say Osprey Gaming, the guys who do the books, and a lot, actually surprisingly a lot of games too in Europe, wanted to produce a medieval, like historically accurate medieval campaign, and it was you could clearly tell that they did the, hey, let me copy your homework, yeah sure, but change it so we don't get caught sort of thing. Understandable. Understandable. If they wanted to use creature and artwork that kind of looked very similar to D&D, you'd be like, yeah, this is just D&D but medieval campaign setting, but as a rule book. Understandable. That's fair and they're right to do so. But again, how this was laid out just wasn't going to do that. I was going to screw over so many people. It was not cool. And like all those old stuff that was already pre-made, gonna be gone. Yeah, again, they're saying backpedaling here again. It was never our intent to impact the vast majority. It was though, with WotC, it was. because you've done this again before with MTG, and we've seen it with Games Workshop. But you could have done it a lot sneakier. Anyways, again, these are the guys who can't even program a freaking software to run tournaments and gave us freaking Dark Alliance. Anyways, the next OGL will contain provisions that allow us to protect and cultivate an inclusive environment. Trying to build and specify the core only content for TRPGs. That means other expressions such as educational, charities, live stream. So basically, they're trying to backpedal again because the thing that made version of D&D so damn popular, next to it actually being like my take on it, despise me disliking 5th edition, it is one of the better versions of a gateway drug into role playing games, tabletop role playing games, next to 4th edition. But 4th edition had a lot of its own issues. So here we are with that. So it's again, they're not going to be affecting, educational videos like how to play, how to write, or we're playing, like Second Life games. They're not going to affect Critical Role. They're not going to affect video game, like media, digital media. It's only going to affect people who are writing content for physical books and PDFs. So we'll go here. What it will not contain is a royalty structure. It will also not include license back provisions that some people were afraid of. If afraid was a means for us to steal our work. So they're basically, again, this is where I was saying a lot of these companies that do sign up these things that allow them to do crossovers, borrow materials, allow them to use words freely without being affected by maybe paying a me like a little fee or something, or letting them print a book. This is giving people still rights to their item and allowing them to say yes or no for WotC to use it. And so, and again, Image Comics was made because of this, because of Marvel with Todd McFarlane taking Venom, forced him to make Image. So this is, we're seeing another Image scenario here with Marvel. So they're basically super hardcore backpedaling, because this was the second big thing that made them like get backlash and boycotted. They're gonna try their best to hide that and be like, yeah, we're not gonna do that. Your stuff is your own. We just, we want back and forth. We want to work together, sort of thing. And then as we end up the sort of scrolling here, the end of this last thoughts. First, we won't be able to release the new OGL. They were see, so they were going to release. This is, in my opinion, this was the biggest thing. This was the thing that I saw a lot about people making videos yesterday about, was that they wanted to release the OGL this month, and it was like yesterday it was supposed to come out. And they were gonna live stream it, they were gonna talk about it, they were gonna do all this stuff, but it got canceled because those big name companies and that one dude and video game companies and stuff were coming out and basically suing them or talking to them about it. They're gonna join, hop onto a different OGL sort of system and just wash Wizards of the Coast away. So yeah, your voices forced us to make changes. Yeah, we freaking caught your bullshit, WotC, again. And now not only do you have the Magic the Gathering players up your ass, you have the D&D community, which is one of the largest gaming things you have next to Magic. And what makes it so large is it is a game system that anyone can play and anyone has played. Unlike where you see games like Games Workshop, where it is majorityly, dominated by those, 30-year-old males who play at their local clubs, and it might be hard to get into because they kind of stick to themselves and kind of push out newcomers, and it looks hard to play. Whereas 5th edition and 4th edition tried, they made a game that is awesome, that's story-based, super welcoming, super open. Take it and make it your own. And even the rule books that state at the beginning, like it is a game that was made as passion and for the player that to be yours. And the rules are more like, to quote that meme from the Pirates, is more of a set of guidelines than rules. And this is what I think hurt us, the community, and why it hurt us on a personal level more than the cheap, sneaky business practice. The ownership issues took a thing that we had a mutual social contract about, where we'll make books to help sell to those fans, and not make a living off of, like, a complete living, like grow a factory and enjoy your world and support and buy your books and push your game and play your game, as long as you sell us stuff and you be cool and interact with us, and we'll not steal your property. We'll just add to it and make it awesome. And they're now cutting that trust is now gone with this new D&D, and it was just a big slap in the face. So we end here with, we realize we did not do this time, and we're sorry for that. They're apologizing. Our goal was to exactly type of feedback, which we ultimately got from you. Any changes this majority could only have been done well if we were willing to take the feedback, no matter how it was provided. So we are. Yeah, again, you weren't going to give us any feedback. You were just going to drop it, but then again, you got caught. Thank you for caring. Yeah, a lot of people's lives were going to get affected by this. To let us know that works and doesn't, what you need and what scares you, without knowing that we can't do our part to make this new Agile match our principles. Finally, we appreciate the chance to make this right. We love D&D's devoted players and creators who take them on. You know what this kind of reminds me of? In the end, this reminds me of 343 getting the rights to Halo. They didn't earn this shit. They didn't get it, and they didn't build it up. They didn't make it. They were just given a thing, and yeah, maybe they have a couple of fans of it, but there was no love in it. You could tell the quality from this end phasing out of D&D 5e and D&D like beyond, like one D&D versus beginning of 5th edition slash middle of, and like 3.5 and Pathfinder. Like, the love, care, the building of with the community that they made versus people that were basically just birthright given, no real respect for, has done. And this has spoiled it. Wizards Coast, you're now on a thin ice with a lot of people. You're being watched by the community, and yeah, it was just a wild ride to watch these last few days. And sorry guys that I didn't get onto it as soon as I did to make a video for YouTube. There was so much going on. Like, every day there was something new, and I wanted to voice this properly with folks and stuff, make sure I had everything and what has you. So I'm gonna quickly here swap to maybe a different channel, see if I can get anyone to like take the bait to join me and have a discussion. Who knows, has the talk. Maybe have one of my friends stop by and say hi. We're gonna go into this channel. There we go. I'm gonna go talk down here. See if anyone pops in. But yeah. So that was the open game license here, guys. We're basically now, I'll basically call it, basically back to game building here. Everything's dried off. But that's the chat. So if you guys want any more sort of, if you want to voice your opinions, you want to ask questions about stuff, even about other games and stuff, like things I've played, feel free to do so. I just ask that you take everyone, be kind to everyone in the chat. Everyone has an opinion, and they have the right to that opinion. So try to keep it, chilled. Everyone's affected by this, and everyone has the right to voice their thought on it. So yeah, start gluing this bad boy here together, and as I finish it up anyway. I'm